So to begin with, I've got my just piece of vegetable tanned leather, and I'm going to mark around the pattern that I've made earlier. I've got a piece for the main part of the sheath, and I've also got a piece for the welt, which will go in the side. It'll be useful to know where the centre of the sheath is, so I make a mark at the top and bottom on the front and prick through to the back. Once I've done that, I can just connect up those lines, and that'll help me fold the sheath later on. Once everything's marked, I can just cut roughly around the pieces. That makes it easier to cut the pieces more accurately later on and make sure that you don't cut any pieces that you don't want to. So we can then come in and actually accurately cut the pieces out. And that's going to be done using a variety of knives. Any kind of straight cuts can be done with a Stanley knife like that. Here you can see me sharpening up the head knife, and when we come to cut round curves, the head knife and the clicker's knife make that easier. The next thing that I want to do is stamp my leather and mark my guidelines. Before I can do any stamping, I need to case the leather, and that's just a case of basically getting some moisture into the leather. So it's dampened down with a sponge, and then we allow the moisture to soak in. So I've set my wing dividers, and the first line that I make is about 1 centimetre from the edge of the leather, and this is going to be a guideline for the border stamping. You'll see that when I get to any tricky areas where it would go around a funny shape, I don't actually join the lines up on the first time round because it's very easy to get that wrong. So I just carefully go around and stop on any corners, and then the second time that I go around, you'll see that I actually join up those corners and make the impression a little bit deeper. Now I can actually start stamping the border, and I'm using a camouflage stamp, and you'll notice that I've not actually got the camouflage stamp resting on the guideline for the border. It's a little bit away, and that just looks a lot better than actually having the kind of feet of the camouflage stamp hitting the border. And then I'm just filling in with a cedar stamp on every other camouflage stamp, just to give a little bit of extra detail to the border. And finally, I'm just using a beveler, and because I haven't actually cut the border, I'm just using it by hand to help add a little bit of definition to the guideline. If I'd actually cut with a swivel knife around that border, then I could actually stamp around with that stamp if I wanted to. While the leather's cased, I'll also use the arbor press just to press in the maker's mark. With the border stamped, I can now also mark my stitching line, and this is in between the edge of the leather and the tooling, so about 5 millimeters. With the stitching line marked, I will just begin to hammer with my pricking iron. This means that when I dye the leather, the tops of the holes will get dyeing, and it just avoids seeing the white bits later on. When we get around to the curve in the sheath, I use a pricking iron with much less teeth on, which allows me to follow the curve in the leather. The next step before we apply any dye is to just bevel any edges that won't be stacked, and that means that we'll be able to fully dye those edges and then burnish them later. I'm also going to use my welt template to mark on the inside of the sheath where the welt will be. This helps to line the sheath up later on in terms of gluing, and also it means that I won't apply any finishes to the inside of the leather where I don't want them. I'm also going to just skive down the belt loop so that it lays a little bit flatter against the back of the sheath before I apply any dye. And now the sheath is actually ready for dyeing, so I'll begin by dyeing the edges of the leather. Then once the edges have been dyed, I can actually go ahead and apply some dye to the inside and outside of the sheath. Any dye applied to the inside of the sheath will stiffen it considerably, so rather than doing the whole thing, I just do the top where you would see. This isn't 100% necessary, but because the belt loop will be folded round, it makes the most sense so that everything looks brown. Once that's dyed, I can actually go ahead and dye the outside of the sheath as well. This will require several applications of dye in order to make it a nice even coat. Once the dye's dried, it can be buffed, and this just removes any surface pigment that may be left over before we move on to the next stages. With the leather buffed, I now apply a coat of neats for oil. This helps to soften the leather and make it more flexible again, because following the dyeing, the leather will be quite stiff due to the oil content in the dye and the fact that the leather's been cased and then dried. Once the dye is dry and the leather's been oiled, we can then burnish any edges which won't be stacked together. So first of all, the edges are wet simply with water, and then once the water's soaked in slightly, it can be burnished with this Cocobolo burnishing tool. When we burnish the edges of leather, it helps to make them smooth and slick and harder than they would be. That gives a nice feel to the edge of the leather, and it also protects the edge of the leather from things like water and grit and things trying to get in and work its way into the leather. Once the burnishing's done, I pay some special attention to the edges because they can tend to roll over slightly when you do the burnishing. So front and back, we just use the flatter part of the burnishing tool to make sure they're nice and slick down. I'm now going to apply a product called Phoebin's Tan Coat to the inside of the sheath, which will also be the belt loop as it folds round. This is a surface finish for leather, but it can also be used on the flesh side just to help slick it down, make it a little bit smoother, and again protect it from kind of, you know, moisture and grit and things like that trying to get into the leather. As I apply it, I'm careful not to apply to the areas where I'm going to be gluing, because the glue won't adhere as well if it's trying to go on top of the tan coat. And you'll see that to apply the tan coat more accurately towards the area where there will be glue, I'm using a small sheep's wool dauber rather than a large cloth, so it's just a lot more accurate. I'm now going to cut out my welt ready for sticking in, and what I'll do is I'll cut it accurately on the inside, but I'll leave excess on the outside that'll be trimmed after everything's sewn up. I'm also not going to cut the very top of the welt off until I've measured it against the sheath itself. And I'll use the welt template to mark the extent of the welt on the back of the roughly cut piece. That means that when I come to glue the sheath together, I'll be able to see exactly where I'm trying to line the edge up. And now I use the sheath itself to mark where the top of the welt needs to be cut. Even though there's a pattern for this, every piece of leather will cut slightly differently, so it's better to use the leather itself rather than to rely on the pattern wherever possible. I also need to trim the bottom of the welt slightly and taper it down so that the sheath closes together nicely at the bottom. and then I can dye and burnish the inside edge of the welt. And now I need to apply this surface finish to the outside of the leather, which is the grain side, and I'm using a product called Snow Seal. Snow Seal is beeswax based and it contains other things to help condition and preserve leather. Because it's beeswax based, it goes on better on warm leather. So first of all, I've heated it with a heat gun and then I'm applying it directly on. And you can see that because the leather's warm, it's helping to melt the product in. Once it's been applied, the leather is reheated to help melt it in, and then a second layer is applied while the leather's still warm. And finally, once both layers have been applied, the leather is buffed and then left to dry. And once everything's dried, it's buffed again quite firmly, just to bring the shine out of the finish. I'm now ready to start actually fitting the knife into the sheath and measuring up. And before I do that, I'm going to wrap cling film around the knife. This avoids any moisture getting onto the knife and causing rust issues, and it also just protects the handle of the knife and everything else from any dye that might be around in the workshop. So the next job is to lay the knife roughly in the sheath and just try and work out where the blade meets the handle, and that's obviously going to be where the knife transitions from being a thin blade into a more bulky area. We'll mark that on the sheath, as you can see. Once we've done that, what we can do is basically mark some guidelines which we're going to then gouge out. So towards the bottom area of the sheath where the blade itself will be, I mark a line either side of the centre just a few millimetres away. Once I've done that in the handle area, I mark two more guidelines which are a little bit further out. Once the guidelines are marked, I use a V-gouge to actually gouge along those lines. And we're removing maybe a third to half of the depth of the leather. The majority of the strength is in the other side of the leather, the grain side, so it doesn't really weaken the leather in any way to do this. I'm now ready to glue the welt into the sheath. So first of all, I roughen up the areas that will be glued, then I apply my contact adhesive. The contact adhesive is a kind of a two-part adhesive, or rather it's applied to both surfaces. So we apply glue to the welt and the sheath, and then once it's had a couple of minutes to tack up, we can stick those together. I'm now getting ready to fold the belt loop over and into place. So the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to mark a line which I'm going to gouge. That's going to help the belt loop fold over. And again, I'll use my V gouge to gouge that out. And you'll notice that rather than running off the end of the leather, what I do is I come in from one side and then I flip the leather around and I gouge from the other side. And that just makes it a little bit neater on the edge rather than actually gouging off the edge of the belt loop. We're now ready to fold some things into place. So before we do that, we're going to dampen the leather down. Anytime that you fold leather, really, it needs to be dampened. That just helps it fold without stressing the leather too much. So I've dampened the belt loop itself, and I'm also dampening those lines that are gouged down to either side of the center line. Once the moisture's soaked in, the first thing that I will do without the knife in the sheath is just start to encourage it to fold over down its centre line and double over on itself. Once the folding's begun, I'll actually introduce the knife into the sheath and start to fold the sheath around the knife itself. What this is going to do is it's going to help me to position the belt loop as accurately as I can so that it's nice and centered. Because if you just fold the belt loop over without the knife in, once you actually make the sheath, you can find that things tend to come out of square a little bit. So with the knife roughly clamped in the sheath there, what I'm doing here is just positioning that belt loop so that it's as central as it can be and that the fold in the belt loop is square to the edge. And once I've got that position, I'm just going to mark very carefully the point of the belt loop so that I know where to glue everything. So I can now open the sheath back out, place the point on the point that I marked, and just carefully mark ever so slightly in from the loop, and that's going to create me a little area that I can scratch and glue. I also need to mark my stitching, and so I'll take my smaller wing dividers. I'll mark following the contour of the belt loop and then use a circle guide just to make a small arc for the top. Once the belt loop's glued into place, I can take my pricking iron and I can hammer that right the way through to the inside so I've got my holes ready for stitching. Although I won't use a stitching groover on the outside of the sheath because it's not really necessary and will spoil the look of the stitching, on the inside where the knife will be rubbing past the thread, I do use a stitching groover to go around that shape so that the stitching is recessed on the inside. So we're now ready to begin stitching, and I'm using a two needle saddle stitch to stitch the belt loop down to the sheath body itself. Saddle stitching is a very traditional leatherwork stitch, and in saddle stitching a needle is held in either hand, and every time you make a stitch the needles pass each other and the threads pass each other within the hole. This creates a very strong stitch, and it's designed such that if a stitch were to be cut or rubbed through on top, there's enough friction and inside the stitches that the stitching shouldn't start to unravel in any way. Before I actually fold up the sheath and sew it closed, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give the belt loop area some special attention. So I'm taking some Japanese burnishing gum and I'm applying that to the flesh side of the leather which we've folded around to make the belt loop. Once I've applied the gum and got it all rubbed in, I'm going to actually give it a good rub, both with a cloth and a burnishing tool. And this is just going to help to extra kind of slick down and protect that area. And you can see that once that's applied, it's darkened down the leather and made it much smoother and kind of cleaner looking as well, really. So we're getting ready to actually glue up the sheath and stitch it closed. But what I'm doing first here is I'm actually using my pricking iron, and while I've got the ability to lay the sheath somewhat flat, I'm hammering through the front of the sheath and also the welt. The sheath is made out of three layers of leather, so by hammering through two layers of leather at this stage accurately, when I come to actually apply an awl, I'm only actually pushing the awl through one layer of leather, which is much easier than pushing it through three layers of leather and will create a much more accurate result. Now, before I actually close the sheath up, I'm also re-dampening it so that when I fold it round, it's not stressing the leather too much. And once that's been dampened down again, I can apply glue to both the welt and the sheath, and then I can fold the sheath up nice and accurately and glue it together. And when I fold it, I'll be using that pen line that you can see on the welt there to line everything up. Once the sheath is stuck together, I'll use the cobbler's hammer to hammer the glue line that helps to set the glue, and then I'll also put some clamps on it and leave it for a couple of days just to let the glue really set before we do the stitching. Now that the sheath's all glued up, it can be stitched. So what you can see me doing here is using a diamond awl to basically create the final holes for the stitching. And because we used the pricking iron to prick through the first two layers, the awl is really only going through the back layer, and that makes it much easier than going through all that thickness there. And what I'm doing is I'm making sure that the holes are coming on the guideline that I marked on the sheath originally, and that makes sure that the stitching's nice and straight on both the front and back of the sheath. With those holes made, I can actually continue saddle stitching down the sheath. Now traditionally you should keep the awl in your hand, and what you should do is basically make one hole and then transfer the awl to the back of your hand, stitch the hole and then bring the awl to the front of your hand, make the next hole and so on. The reason that you don't put the awl down really is to keep consistency in the angle of the holes. Because the angle of these holes were set by the pricking iron, I find it much easier to basically drop the needles, use the awl to make maybe 6 or 10 holes, stitch down those holes, pick the awl back up, and so on. I find that much easier than trying to kind of keep the awl in my hands. And once that stitching is complete, again it's put on the marble and hammered with the cobbler's hammer. This just helps to even out any tension in the stitching, it helps to flatten the stitching down and just create the final appearance of the stitching. So the first thing that I'm doing here is I'm just trimming off some of that excess welt. Before I do the final sanding, I will actually wet form the sheath slightly to the knife, and what I'm about to demonstrate here is how the drainage holes work by not lining it up over the bowl properly. So obviously that's normally done over a sink, but for filming purposes it was done with a bowl. So you don't really need to soak the knife sheath particularly. What I would do ordinarily is simply place it under the tap, fill it up with water, tip the water straight back out, and that sufficiently dampens the leather inside to do a little bit of wet forming. There's no need to actually soak the leather at this stage. So with the leather dampened, the knife can be carefully inserted in, and what we do is a little bit of gentle wet forming. There's really no need to bone and form the sheath very, very crisply to the knife, but if you just kind of run your fingers around the contours of the knife, it helps to create a little pocket for the knife to kind of snap into. And once this leather is allowed to dry, that shape will be permanently in there. After that sheath has been allowed to dry, we can actually continue with the edge finishing. So the first thing that I will do is sand the edges with a belt sander. I've got two different grits on the belt sander. The round wheel on the side is a rougher grit, and then the long belt on top is a much finer grit. So I essentially true up the edge and make sure that all three layers of the leather are nice and flush with the rough one. And then I'll move up to the top side. Thank you. Once that belt sanding to remove the bulk of the material there, which you could also do with sandpaper if you want, the rest of this is all now hand finishing. So the first thing that I'm doing is I'm using a piece of micro mesh, which is a kind of wet and dry paper. What I do is I actually wet that down and then just begin to sand the edge, and that's like the third level of sanding really. And once that's been done, I can take the beveling tool and I can bevel around both sides. With the edges sanded and beveled, I can now come in and carefully apply dye to the edge before we do the final burnishing. If you do all the burnishing before you try and dye the edge, the dye doesn't really go into the edge because it's too slick, so the dye needs to be done at this stage. So once the dye's dried, we move on to the final burnishing. So again, I apply just water to the edge to moisten the edge down. And once the water has been applied, I go back to my burnishing tool and I begin to actually burnish the edges by hand. So the first thing that I'm doing is I'm using one of the rounded parts of the tool to get the kind of edges nicely slicked. And once that's been done, I'll go to the flatter part and I'll actually use the flatter part to get the flat edge. So once the edges have been burnished with water, I come back to the Japanese burnishing gum and I apply a layer of that, and this helps to burnish the edge even further, and it also seals and protects the edge just a little bit more as well. With the burnishing done, the sheath's complete, so the last thing to do is to just give the knife a final fit, make sure that it's nice and tight but not too tight, and then just a final polish as well to remove any little bits of leather that might be stuck on there from the workshop. And that's it, once the sheath's had a rub down, everything is complete. So hope you've enjoyed watching that video. It's shown really all the steps, there's nothing missed out there. And these steps are common to lots of leatherwork projects as well, not just knife sheaths. Okay, thank you for watching.